the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Philippine health authorities locate five travelers who arrived recently from South Africa. The Philippine Justice Department official says a Supreme Court's ruling on the anti-terror law gives more clarity on its implementation. America pledges to set up new funding to bolster democracy worldwide. And later on in the program, we'll tackle political ad trends for the 2022 polls with Jay Bautista of Kantar, Philippines. I'm Rain Musni. Dayline Philippines begins right now. For those of you watching us on YouTube and Facebook, glad you could join us. Our top story for today. Philippine authorities locate five more travelers from South Africa. They are part of the group of eight that were earlier declared missing by the health authorities after they provided incomplete information on their contact tracing forms. They arrived in the country between November 15 and 29 before a travel ban on several African countries was imposed due to the emergence of the Omicron variant. The health department says the five are now in quarantine. Two have tested negative while the others are waiting their results. One of the travelers was located last Monday, leaving just two unaccounted for. The Philippines remains Omicron-free for now. The health department says the new COVID variant was not detected in the latest genome sequencing. Most of the 48 sequenced samples were infected with the Delta variant. However, this batch does not include samples collected from travelers from South Africa, Burkina Faso, and Egypt who tested positive for COVID. While the Omicron's presence in the country has yet to be confirmed, an infectious disease specialist suspects it's already here.
Yung surveillance natin ng genomic is not as extensive as other countries. That's why Australia has a very good genomic surveillance, no? And even South Africa. We should be thinking that Omicron variant is here, and that's why we should be extra careful.
Dr. Solante also urges more Filipinos to get vaccinated. The Philippines logged 562 new COVID infections Thursday. This is the fourth straight day that the new COVID cases in the country have fallen below 600. But the death toll is approaching the 50,000 mark. Health officials confirmed 176 more fatalities. The number of active cases remains at the 12,000 level. The country's hospital situation continues to improve amid the dip in COVID-19 cases. COVID-19 hospitalization chief Dr. Leopoldo Vega says several health facilities have been reporting no new patients infected with the virus in the last 5 days. Vega adds they've been receiving less COVID-19 related calls in the One Hospital Command Center.
Dito sa Metro Manila, mapapansin po natin sa data ho namin sa One Hospital Command, sa out of 158 ata na hospitals na nandito po sa Metro Manila, 62% yan wala na hong COVID for the last 5 days. So mga 39% yan sa Metro Manila, eh wala na silang admission for COVID for the last 5 days. Ganun din yan sa lahat ng mga regions. Ang hospitals ngayon ay dahan-dahan na nagbubukas, lalong-lalo na sa mga elective operations na talagang na-postpone nung panahon ng COVID, at saka nagbubukas na rin sila sa mga non-COVID na nangangailangan talaga, lalo na sa mga emergency at mga kailangang urgent surgical operations.
Singapore has detected its first locally transmitted case of the Omicron variant. Authorities say an airport staff member is the first Omicron case in the city-state with no travel history. The patient is now fully vaccinated against COVID-19 and is currently asymptomatic. Officials now warn more Omicron cases are likely to be detected. Singapore had previously detected 3 Omicron cases, all found in overseas travelers. In other news, the Justice Department believes the Supreme Court's ruling on the anti-terror law will make for its better implementation. The High Court only struck down portions of the law that tend to violate the principles of freedom of expression or allow the designation of a person or a group of terrorists based on a request by another country. Undersecretary Adrian Sugai points out the High Court was able to further define what terrorism is and what are not considered terrorist acts. But he admits he was surprised there wasn't any specific comment on Section 29 of the measure, which allows detention without judicial warrant of arrest and detention of up to 24 days. Many thought this would be the provision that would most likely be struck down.
It's really the whole concept of extended detention. You know, it's that in itself is already problematic. It's a contentious provision of the law, and we saw it fit to the best of our ability to clarify it and to clarify it consistent with existing law and provisions of the rules of court. That's really the whole point of having a set of implementing rules and regulations. It's really for purposes of detailing or ensuring the proper implementation of any law.
The IRR of the anti-terror law clarified that Section 29 would be limited to warrantless arrests under the revised rules on criminal procedure. Government officials also welcomed the SE's ruling on the anti-terror law. National Security Advisor and Anti-Terrorism Council Vice Chairman Hermogenes Esperon Jr. says he's happy with it, even though some portions were struck down. Interior Secretary Eduardo Año, meanwhile, says the ruling will have minimal effect on the law's implementation. For its part, the Office of the Solicitor General says this latest development will be a big boost in defending the country against terrorism. As for Malacañang, it's withholding comment until it gets its hands on the full document. Well, human rights lawyer attorney Shell Diokno not surprised with the Supreme Court's move to leave most of the anti-terror law's provisions untouched. Diokno, chairman of the Free Legal Assistance Group and a senatorial aspirant, says more provisions could be deemed invalid within the course of the law's implementation.
As the law will be implemented and people are affected by the provisions of the law, they can, of course, question what's being done to them. And that could lead to further invalidations of provisions of the law. In the struggle for basic rights, in the struggle for maintaining our democracy, there will always be setbacks that will happen. We've known this since the time of the Marcos dictatorship, and it took a number of years before we eventually were able to boot out that dictator. And in that struggle, we know that it's not going to be easy. We know that we will continue to stand up for our rights. And regardless of how the courts may view the situation, we will just continue to fight for our rights.
The winners of this year's Nobel Peace Prize speak out about the problems and dangers faced by journalists around the world a day before collecting their award in a ceremony in Oslo, Norway. Journalists Maria Ressa and Dmitry Muratov braved the wrath of the leaders of the Philippines and Russia to expose corruption and misrule in their countries. As the Philippines prepares to hold presidential elections next year, Ressa says the voting cannot be conducted with integrity as long as social media platforms are amplifying lies.
It's the impact of technology. We journalists lost our gatekeeping powers, and I would peg that around 2014, 2015. And the new gatekeepers is technology, social media companies that have essentially watered down facts.
Well, U.S. President Joe Biden pledges a new fund to support free press worldwide. At the first-of-its-kind virtual summit for democracy, Biden called on the more than 100 world leaders in attendance to join him in countering democratic backsliding worldwide. He also stressed a free press is critical to democracy. The White House has announced it is working with Congress to provide $424.4 million toward a new initiative to bolster democracy worldwide. This includes support to independent news media.
We're committing critical seed money to launch a new multilateral effort of our International Fund for Public Interest Media to sustain independent media around the world. And through our USAID, we're going to be standing up a new defamation defense fund for journalists to help protect investigative journalists against nuisance lawsuits designed to prevent them from doing their work.
The conference is a test of Biden's assertion that he would return the U.S. to global leadership to face down authoritarian forces after the country's global standing took a beating under his predecessor. Video sharing platform YouTube beefs up efforts to fight misinformation. YouTube said users will now be seeing information from third-party sources alongside videos on a number of topics that are prone to misinformation. These topics include climate change, the 9/11 attacks, the Holocaust, the Apollo moon landing, and martial law in the Philippines. Google Philippines describes the move as a critical next step in providing YouTube users with additional context to videos in the platform. YouTube said the information panel will appear regardless of opinions and perspectives expressed on the video being played. Up next, we'll talk about emerging campaign trends amid the pandemic with Kantar Philippines Managing Director Jay Bautista. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us. Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Dateline Philippines, here's another look at the headlines. Philippine authorities locate 5 travelers who arrived recently from South Africa. A Philippine Justice Department official says the Supreme Court's ruling on the anti-terror law gives more clarity on its implementation. And America pledges to set up new funding to bolster democracy worldwide. Now, more than ever, candidates in next year's elections are making full use of digital platforms, but that doesn't mean they're no longer burning cash via traditional media to reach more voters. Here to tell us about the trends in the political campaigns of the 2022 polls is Jay Bautista. He's Managing Director of Kantar Philippines. Jay, good afternoon and grateful you could join us today.
Thank you, Rain, for having me.
The official campaign period doesn't start until March 25 next year, but already we're seeing a lot of political campaigns on both traditional and digital media. And Kantar Philippines is monitoring that, and you did a quick graphic on that. Can you help us go through some of the highlights?
Yes. Traditionally, a year before any elections, whether midterm or national, we see activity on the advertising front. These are now termed as policies or political advocacies. This year is very different because we've started tracking the digital aspect as well. while we see the normal spending on television across the different national positions, it's the first time we're seeing how much they're really spending on online in terms of standard advertising executions. So right now, I think the top advertisers include some of the candidates who are not doing well in the surveys.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, we're also seeing that digital is taking no more than 20% of the ad spend of the presidential and senatorial candidates. Digital spend is dominated by candidates believed to be part of the opposition, but visibly absent here is the ad spend of presidential aspirant Ferdinand Marcos Jr. But Marcos is believed to have spent the most and longer leading up to the filing of candidacies, especially on social media. Can you share with us what makes his campaign unique?
Yes, I think their strategy is leaning towards more of less paid, but more of organic or earned media and owned media. So that's, I think, where the investments are putting the resources in. If you go to Facebook or TikTok or YouTube, you'd see, and if you count the number of owned platforms that they have, they run into hundreds of Facebook pages, TikTok accounts, and even the YouTube channel. So I think right now they're avoiding traditional paid advertising in favor of the more organic or less direct selling approach.
Well, just today we saw a story on how a new study claims Facebook misidentified tens of thousands of advertisements flagged under its political ads policy. That's up to 83% wrong in the U.S. and Brazil elections. But this organic messaging, is this a new trend for the 2022 elections, or is this something that you'd already seen in 2016? And because there remain issues such as political messaging, such as A, if it's not classified as advertising, then no one has to declare who paid for the post or keep count, or do digital channels keep track of that? And B, is there an ethical issue in buying up social media pages with huge following and taking over it with one's political messaging? We're not even talking about using social media influencers for their campaigns yet.
On the first point, we've already seen this type of strategy back in 2016 with the Duterte campaign. This time around, we're seeing it amplified because of the recent changes in the landscape. First, the pandemic accelerated the digital transformation of our daily habits. So we're more inclined towards online activities today. The second factor we see is this will be the first elections where the youth vote will really be dominant, where more than 50% of our registered voters belong to the Gen Z and millennial segment. And we, as we all know, the Gen Zs and millennials default towards digital or social media as their go-to medium for information. And I think that's where the questions about ethics and the way to track spending comes into the picture, because if it's not executed like a normal ad and sort of hidden behind content or information dissemination, then definitely the amounts of monies or investments made on those executions cannot be defined as political advocacy spending.
Well, Jay, if there's greater ad spend on TV, as you had pointed out in your graphic, and greater usage of social media, do you think traditional media is still the best way to go over digital campaigns? And do you see this demand causing an adjustment in the prices of TV exposure? And if candidates are not spending on these media, though, where else are they taking their campaign funds if they want to make an impact?
Okay, so there's I think a complementary nature to the relationship between digital and television advertising. TV is still a part, especially in areas where the internet infrastructure is still not stable enough. Digital, on the other hand, allows you micro-targeting, which involves the ability to engage with voters or potential voters and hopefully convince them with your platform or messaging. So moving forward, again, because of the change in the landscape with the ABS shutdown last year, we'll see that, you know, other platforms like radio will come into the picture to bridge the gap with the audience that cannot be reached by the TV stations, for example, that have been left operating right now. So moving forward, as we come to the elections, and if face-to-face campaigning is still limited, we will definitely see more spending this time around compared to previous years.
Right. Well, all of these metrics, of course, is made possible through your new service, and we're pulling up your digital advertising intelligence on consumer goods graphic right now. It also shows your e-commerce tracking, which seems to show insights on what type of ads are most in demand, who spends the most, and which social media channels take the cake in ad spend. Can you share with us what this graphic means?
Yes. In fact, the political advocacy is just an extract of this major report or service. Only 3% of the spending on online is currently accounted for by political advocacies. Majority is still focused on fast-moving consumer goods, e-commerce, as you mentioned, and quick service restaurants who've tried to transform because of the pandemic to focus more on deliveries or takeout services. And the $15 billion a month average that we monitored for digital on a monthly basis actually makes digital second to TV as the most spent on platform currently in the Philippines. Digital has officially overtaken platforms like radio, print, and out of home, again, because of the dynamics of the pandemic, limited mobility, and digital transformation over the last 20 months.
Mm-mm. Well, Jay, back to politicies. It's still early in the game, and it's still 5 months before the May 2022 elections. You did mention that you expect ad spend to accelerate, but in which forms or in which media, perhaps?
Traditionally, this year, I would forecast that it will be television, digital, and radio, which would be the primary platforms as the official campaign period starts. And we will see more of these below the line or under the radar activities masking themselves as organic content dissemination among the candidates.
By how much more can the ad spend actually grow between now and March, when the campaign season actually starts?
Historically, the year before the campaigns, politicies account for about 3% of total ad spend. That's around $6 billion in the past two elections. And then once the official campaign period starts, we expect the share to grow to about 5 to 6% of total ad spend. So we haven't seen, you know, the bulk of the advertising compared.
Well, lots to look forward to there, and always a pleasure to speak with you, Jay Bautista of Kantar Philippines. Great to have you with us. Thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate it.
You're most welcome. Thank you.
Well, still ahead, the death toll in the volcanic eruption in Indonesia climbs past 40. This is Dateline Philippines. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
In the country, 94.2 million of these were administered as of last Wednesday. With tens of millions of COVID vaccine doses waiting to be jabbed and amid the threat of the Omicron variant, National Task Force Against COVID-19 Special Advisor Dr. Teodoro Herbosa urges unvaccinated Filipinos and those due for a booster or additional COVID shot to get vaccinated. Herbosa adds they are allowed to walk in at vaccination sites on the second phase of the Bayanihan Bakunahan National COVID Vaccination Drive from December 15 to 17. The National Vaccination Operations Center advised LGUs to be better prepared to accommodate eligible walk-ins during this period. Still, the NTF recommends individuals to pre-register if possible to speed up the process in vaccination centers. Rain, back to you.
Thank you so much for that report, Vivian Gulia. Well, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration expands the authorization of Pfizer-BioNTech's COVID-19 booster shot to include 16 and 17-year-olds. The FDA's decision comes a day after the company's released lab results that showed three doses of their vaccine appeared effective against the Omicron variant. The expanded emergency use authorization is now up for review by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention before it will be rolled out. President Joe Biden hails the expanded EUA. He also called on Americans to get their booster shots.
50 million people now have gotten their booster shots. And we're getting people their booster shots at a record pace, roughly 1 million people a day. And America is making progress, 200 million with two shots, and more kids vaccinated than any country on earth. And we got a lot of work to do, but we're gonna get through this. We're gonna make it through this. And we're gonna be okay, in my view.
Another look now at our top stories. Philippine authorities locate five more travelers from South Africa. They're part of the group of eight that were earlier declared missing by health authorities after they provided incomplete information on their contact tracing forms. They arrived in the country between November 15 and 29 before the travel ban on several African countries was imposed due to the emergence of the Omicron variant. The health department says the five are now in quarantine. Two have tested negative, while the others are awaiting their test results. One of the travelers was located last Monday, leaving just two unaccounted for. The Philippines remains Omicron-free for now. The health department says the new COVID variant was not detected in the latest genome sequencing. Most of the 48 sequence samples were infected with a Delta variant. However, this batch does not include samples collected from travelers from South Africa, Burkina Faso, and Egypt who tested positive for COVID. While the Omicron's presence in the country has yet to be confirmed, an infectious disease specialist suspects it's already here.
Yung surveillance natin ng genomic is not as extensive as other countries. That's why Australia has a very good genomic surveillance, no? And even South Africa. We should be thinking that Omicron variant is here, and that's why we should be extra careful.
Dr. Solante also urges more Filipinos to get vaccinated. Well, the Philippines logged 562 new COVID infections Thursday. This is the fourth straight day that new COVID cases in the country have fallen below 600, but the death toll is approaching the 50,000 mark. Health officials confirmed 176 more fatalities. The number of active cases remains at the 12,000 level. The country's hospital situation continues to improve amid the dip in COVID-19 cases. COVID-19 hospitalization chief Dr. Leopoldo Vega says several health facilities have been reporting no new patients infected with the virus in the last 5 days. Vega adds they've been receiving less COVID-19 related calls in the one hospital command center.
Dito sa Metro Manila, mapapansin po natin sa data ho namin sa One Hospital Command, sa out of 158 ata na hospitals na nandito po sa Metro Manila, 62% niyan wala na hong COVID for the last 5 days. So mga 39% yan sa Metro Manila, eh wala na silang admission for COVID for the last 5 days. Ganun din yan sa lahat ng mga regions. Ang hospitals ngayon ay dahan-dahan na nagbubukas, lalong-lalo na sa mga elective operations na talagang na-postpone nung panahon ng COVID, at saka nagbubukas na rin sila sa mga non-COVID na nangangailangan talaga, lalo na sa mga emergency at mga kailangang urgent surgical operations.
Well, Singapore has detected its first locally transmitted case of the Omicron variant. Authorities say an airport staff member is the first Omicron case in the city-state with no travel history. The patient is fully vaccinated against COVID-19 and is currently asymptomatic. Officials say we're now warned more Omicron cases are likely to be detected. Singapore had previously detected three Omicron cases, all found in overseas travelers. The Justice Department believes the Supreme Court's ruling on the anti-terror law will make for its better implementation. The High Court only struck down portions of the law that tend to violate the principles of freedom of expression or allow the designation of a person or a group as terrorists based on a request by another country. Undersecretary Adrian Sugai points out the High Court was able to further define what terrorism is and what are not considered terrorist acts. But he admits he was surprised there wasn't any specific comment on Section 29 of the measure, which allows detention without judicial arrest or warrant of arrest and detention of up to 24 days. Many thought this would be the provision that would most likely be struck down.
It's really the whole concept of extended detention. You know, it's that in itself is already problematic. It's a contentious provision of the law, and we saw it fit to the best of our ability to clarify it and to clarify it consistent with existing law and provisions of the rules of court. That's really the whole point of having a set of implementing rules and regulations. It's really for purposes of detailing or ensuring the proper implementation of any law.
The IRR of the anti-terror law clarified that Section 29 would be limited to warrantless arrest under the revised rules on criminal procedure. Government officials also welcomed the SC's ruling on the high anti-terror law. National Security Advisor and Anti-Terrorism Council Vice Chairman Hermogenes Esperon Jr. says he's happy with it, even though some portions were struck down. Interior Secretary Eduardo Año, meanwhile, says the ruling will have minimal effect on the law's implementation. For its part, the Office of the Solicitor General says this latest development will be a big boost in defending the country against terrorism. As for Malacañang, it's withholding comment until it gets its hands on the full document. Human rights lawyer attorney Shell Diokno, not surprised with the Supreme Court's move to leave most of the anti-terror law's provisions untouched. Diokno, chairman of the Free Legal Assistance Group and a senatorial aspirant, says more provisions could be deemed invalid within the course of the law's implementation.
As the law will be implemented and people are affected by the provisions of the law, they can, of course, question what's being done to them, and that could lead to further invalidations of provisions of the law. In the struggle for basic rights, in the struggle for maintaining our democracy, there will always be setbacks that will happen. We've known this since the time of the Marcos dictatorship, and it took a number of years before we eventually were able to boot out that dictator. And in that struggle, we know that it's not going to be easy. We know that we will continue to stand up for our rights. And regardless of how the courts may view the situation, we will just continue to fight for our rights.
Philippine media groups disturbed by the fatal shooting of a veteran Filipino newsman in the province of Samar. The murder of Jess Malabanan adds to the growing number of journalists killed during the Duterte administration. Jervis Manahan reports.
Journalists from Pampanga held a candlelight vigil Thursday to honor the memory and work of slain journalist Jesus Jess Malabanan. The killing took place 2 days before the International Human Rights Day. Malabanan was a Pampanga-based journalist who was a correspondent of Manila Standard Today and was also a Pampanga stringer for Reuters, Bandera, and ABS-CBN News.
Siyempre, katarungan yung gusto namin. Hindi lang yung pumatay ang makulong, pati yung nagpapatay. Father ko, napakabakit na tao. At wala silang karapatan na kumitil ng buhay ng kung sino man.
Award-winning journalist Manny Mugato said Malabanan was a longtime dedicated journalist who helped immensely in the drug war stories that eventually won the Pulitzer in 2018. Malabanan was watching television in his home in San Joaquin Village, Tinambacan District, when unidentified gunmen fatally shot him. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines Pampanga Chapter also extended their sympathies to the bereaved family. The Pampanga Press Club, where Malabanan was a member, strongly condemned the incident.
Kilala po siya bilang dedicated na isang periodista. At kami po ngayon ay nananawagan sa ating kapulisan at sa mga otoridad na paitingin po ang investigasyon para mabigyan po ng hustisya ang walang saysay na pagpaslang kay Ginoong Jess Malabanan.
The Presidential Task Force on Media Security vowed to investigate the incident until the perpetrators are caught.
The PNP is doing its best to immediately identify and arrest the person responsible for the death of journalist Jesus Malabanan in Calbayog City. Police General Gennaro Carlos instructed the Regional Director of Police Regional Office 8 to create a special investigation task group to expedite the resolution of this case.
The Commission on Human Rights also said they will be conducting a parallel investigation on the case. According to the CHR, Malabanan was the 22nd journalist killed under the present administration. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
World news now. The death toll from the tragic volcano eruption on Indonesia's most populated island rises to 43. 13 people remain missing. The country's disaster mitigation agency says the eruption left around 6,500 people displaced and some 3,000 houses damaged. Authorities urge the public to avoid the vicinity of the volcano as it continues to emit volcanic ash. Indonesia is now considering relocations after the incident. Another tragedy, this time in Mexico. At least 53 have been killed in a trailer crash in the southern Mexican state of Chiapas. 58 others are injured. Officials say the accident occurred when a large trailer overturned on a dangerous curve outside the city. Most of the victims were migrants from Central America. Migrants fleeing poverty and violence in that region typically trek through Mexico to reach the U.S. border and cram themselves into large trucks organized by human smugglers. The U.S. Senate clears the last major hurdle to raising America's debt ceiling. The upper chamber advanced the first of two bills needed for the hike. The breakthrough came after 14 Republicans joined Democrats to end the debate on the bill, spurning right-wing demands that they boycott any measure leading to an increase in the Treasury Department's borrowing authority. U.S. President Joe Biden is expected to immediately sign the bill into law. That would pave the way for a separate vote to raise the debt limit by as much as $2.5 trillion by next week. This latest development puts Congress on track to avoid a fiscal crisis with little time to spare. The Treasury Department has said it would breach or it could breach the statutory debt limit after December 15th. The Philippine trade deficit widens in October. It came in at over $4 billion, slightly higher than September's $3.99 billion. This marked the largest trade gap since April 2020 as exports edged up 2% year-on-year to $6.41 billion, while imports surged 25.1% to a 35-month high of $10.43 billion. Of the top 10 major commodity groups in terms of the value of exports, seven recorded annual increases led by coconut oil. Meanwhile, the surge of imported goods was due to an increase in eight of the top 10 major commodity groups, which was led by mineral fuels, lubricants, and related materials. China is the Philippines' top export partner, followed by the U.S., Hong Kong, Japan, and Singapore. Foreign direct investments into the Philippines rose in September. It climbed 30% from $506 million in the same period last year. This brings total FDIs from the first to third quarter of 2021 to $7.3 billion. That's nearly 44% higher compared to the $5 billion net inflows recorded in the first 9 months last year. Despite improving numbers, several lawmakers are urging government to rethink its incentives as neighboring countries outpace foreign investments in the Philippines. Tech giant Apple remains within striking distance of a $3 trillion market capitalization, a milestone that would make it as big as the world's fifth largest economy, India. shares of Apple now trading around $174. It needs to reach at least $182.85 to hit the $3 trillion market cap. The stock has jumped about 30% this year on top of the 80% surge in 2020. Its peers in the trillion-dollar club, Microsoft, Amazon, Alphabet, and Tesla, have all gained between 10 and 70%.
Kind of proves the fact that Apple, again, becomes one of the largest companies in the world, and it becomes kind of speaks to the durability of its growth and the scale of its operation. So that may make more investors or retail investors more comfortable investing in Apple for the longer term. Now that iPhone and its first services becomes a very integral part of a consumer's life. In a way, it's shocking to see it as large as a country, but in another way, it's a natural result of a company that are producing a piece of must-have consumer hardware that also happens to be the highest in quality.
Apple was the first company to hit the $1 trillion market cap in 2018, and it doubled that valuation last year. The Philippine Central Bank vows continued commitment to promote a financial system that is inclusive of persons with disability. It says it has issued several regulations aimed at upholding laws that protect the rights of PWDs. The Central Bank has also urged BSP-supervised financial institutions to observe non-discriminatory practices such as a risk-based customer acceptance and identification policy to make it easier for PWDs. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. On to sports now. The Utah Jazz notched their sixth straight victory with an easy 118-96 win against the Philadelphia 76ers. The all-star duo of Donovan Mitchell and Rudy Gobert anchored Utah's attack. Mitchell dropped 117 of its 22 points in the first half, while Gobert added 17 points and 21 rebounds. Utah improved to 18-7, third best record in the league, behind only Golden State and Phoenix. And before we go, don't forget to catch In Focus next week as Carmina Constantino speaks to health advocate and online celebrity Doc Willie Ong, who is gunning for the second highest post in next year's polls. That interview with Aksyon Demokratiko's vice presidential bet will be on December 17 here on Dateline Philippines. Have questions? Send them in to ANC Alerts on Twitter and ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Use the hashtag ANC In Focus. And that'll do it for today. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Rain Musngi. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcast. Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe, everyone, as you keep it here on the news channel.